Good afternoon, everyone. How are we doing? Yeah, it's that graveyard slot. Thank you. Thanks to our panel, because those guys are essentially the guys who know the really scary stories. I'm going to talk to you today about storytelling as a concept, but those guys have got some fantastic stories to tell, especially Andy Chandler. Thank you for that, Andy, for chairing so professionally. Yes, good man. Awesome guy. There we go. My role here is as a complete fraud, just to do this from the offset. I've not got a background in security at all. I come from a theatre and television background. Two things you should know about me. I am ADHD, so strap in. Oh, yeah. We all meet up and bond on these things, and then we can't decide what to do. And the second thing is that I trained for 5 years as an opera singer. Don't panic. It's not going to happen. Because I'm ADHD, I can't decide which one to sing. And so we're safe. So not coming from a security background, what tends to happen is that we use entertainment to change behavior. Because it's actually, like anything in life, if you can change people's perceptions and behavior, you can get a lot done. You can recruit without them even knowing that they've been recruited. I'm talking about employees in any organization. I have a cause. It is basically to bring some kind of effectiveness back to employee communications. Often what happens, especially in large organizations, is we have an internal communications team. They send out missives very often. They try to put posters up. They do all sorts of things. They're all very carefully branded, very slick, very professional. They may put together things like a mission statement that's been done by a committee of 12 people, which means it's completely unintelligible. But what we want to do is to use what I know about entertainment and marketing to engage the workforce. And as we get involved with more and more complex security issues, sometimes you get a kind of leakage out to the workforce about things you want them to do or to think or to act on. And they may get confused, because not all of them are as technically minded. And a lot of them just get kind of inured to that communication. They're always being told about these things, and so they kind of start to ignore it a little bit. So, I'll give you an idea of the kind of thing that employees are subject to. Now, this is an example of some training. And if you just ask yourself how you would feel if you were told to sit down in front of this. Let's have a look.
Welcome back to section 17 of Ethical Business Practice and You. In this section, we're going to be covering the fundamentals of anti-bribery, focusing on a broad range of scenarios which you'll be tested at the end of this section. Hope you have your tickets ready. It's time to board the train. Destination, knowledge. All aboard.
Okay. Can you hear me, by the way? You can all hear me. I'm theatre trained, so I shouldn't really need a microphone, darlings. So, yeah, and this is not unusual to see this type of thing. The thing is, in the first place, when we're doing things about training and compliance, we never ask the question, who the heck wants to be trained to comply? Mostly the training and awareness is an interruption to their day. They've got numbers to hit, they've got a job to do, and you're really asking them to stop that and engage with something. The very least you could do is perhaps make it more interesting and engaging. So the problem is, if we're going to develop a culture of information security awareness, we need everyone's attention. And you're not going to get it with things like that. And to get attention, we need relevance and appeal. This is marketing speak. Relevance is, what's in it for me? Appeal is, do I just like it? It's really basic. And so awareness programs, whilst they could be relevant, often lack any kind of appeal. And awareness is not the same as engagement. And one thing so to illustrate that point, if you can imagine you're driving down a road and you see the speed limit on a sign, I am now aware of the speed limit. And of course, if you saw that, you would all immediately stick to the speed limit. Yeah? Because you're aware, right? So what could possibly go wrong with that plan? However, if you're driving around a roundabout and it's been raining, you're going a little bit too quick and the back of the car just skips a little bit, that's engagement. We're now fully awake and we're back on top of this job of driving. And that's what I'm talking about. It's an emotional connection, not necessarily an information exchange. Let me give you an idea of what I think about companies' attempts to talk to human beings.
I love you too, Simon.
And we've been seeing each other for...
1 year, 5 months, 3 weeks, 2 days, 1.5 hours.
Well, I've been thinking. And I think it's time we thought about our future. There's something I want to say. And I want it to be perfect. And I think we should go back, darling. Darling Natalie. And look at our journey that brought us here.
So, the journey. As you can see, darling, from this graph, the first quarter started fantastically well, accelerating very quickly to this point here, and we achieved maximum penetration.
It's a marketing term, right? It's a marketing term.
Then around May bank holiday, I met your mother for the first time. Steep downward plummet, but we consolidated this by moving in together. And the merger of both things brought one thing to light. We have one major thing in...
I had a ring and everything.
And that's what happens if a corporation would try to propose to a lady. So I'm aware of the speed limit, but do I care? We're trying to start the right kinds of conversations in organizations, and we know that storytelling is a stronger structure for memorability than simple information like bullet points or lots of PowerPoint slides. And so our weapon in this crusade is storytelling. Neurologically, stories connect with a part of our brain that places us in the story. This is a known theory. Well, not a known theory, it's definitely something that happens. So if we are watching a TV program or we're hearing a story being read to us, we imagine that scenario and we actually, the brain is placing us in it. So we have extreme empathy with that story. It's very powerful stuff. We're properly engaged, and it's why the entertainment industry does so well with movies and TV. I want to do a small experiment with you now. I'm going to get somebody to help me tell a story about themselves. Now then, I'm not going to give away too much personal information, but there is one vital bit of personal information I will need. Can you tell me, anyone in the room, and be brave, if you had a nickname at school, put your hand up if you had a nickname at school. Somebody at the back there, this gentleman. That gentleman there, this young lady, and, oh, right, okay, I'm sorry, I'm just going to pick on Andy, if that's right. Andy, what was your nickname?
T-O-P.
Okay, hold on a second, hold that thought. So at the back there, what was your nickname?
Willie the Wombat.
Okay, I'm going to go with Willie the Wombat, I hope that's okay. Just from a story point of view. Now, so what is your name, William, by any chance? Surname Williamson, right, okay. So the wombat thing is interesting. Could you please describe to us all, as clearly as you can, the circumstances surrounding when you found out you had that nickname? Willie the Wombat, yeah? Right. Oh, right, so everybody knew this character. Right, was there a moment you can remember when you thought, oh, right, that's me then? Right. So it just emerged one day that that was it. Who else has heard of Willy the Wombat, the TV program? I haven't. What part of the world was that in? Okay, was it in the UK? Was it in the UK?
Yeah, yeah.
It was. All right, interesting. Because I wouldn't put us that far apart age-wise, so I don't know why there's a gap in my childhood there with Willy the Wombat. What was the most embarrassing moment for you at school that you had, that you could tell us about, without fear of any kind of mental damage? Oh, okay. I'm putting you on the spot a little bit. I realise that's a bit unfair. What was your school like? Did you have a favourite teacher? Well, one of them was?
One of them was completely loopy.
Loopy. And was lots of fun.
Yeah.
And so this unstable teacher, what sort of things did they do?
The funny way he grabbed our attention was when he walked up to us and said, would you like to buy an oven-ready penguin?
Would you like to buy an oven-ready penguin? And I presume he didn't have one or trust.
We said yes.
Yes.
We had to test
this out. Oh. Right, so this was a real experiment you did at school.
Yeah. Come to the staff room at the end of lunchtime, and we did. He came out with a paper towel covered with red ink and said it was there prepared, but it got away.
Thank you, sir. I really appreciate you telling us that story. Can I get a round of applause? So Willy the Wombat telling us a story about an oven-ready penguin. We'll take that to the grave, I'm sure we will. What happens when television wants to tell stories? Well, first of all, it has to sell the idea of telling a story. And for that, does anyone like this series? Anyone know this series? Any fans of Big Bang Theory? It's great, isn't it? Everything I know about thermonuclear dynamics I learned from this program. And of course, they had a marketing team, and of course, they had merchandise and posters by the road, and they cover multiple channels. If we wanted to make a transaction with our workforce, I believe that we should do things that they do at home. So if they like to consume media at home, we should give them some media to consume at work. We should treat it like a marketer would, like a campaign. So if we were selling the notion of your responsibility as an individual with respect to information security, I'm going to have to give you something in return for that, because that's quite a tough sell. Yeah? I want you to stop work and consider this. But if I want your attention, how about we do what the marketers do, and in return I'll give you some entertainment or just something appealing that's relevant to you. So perhaps we should be thinking about selling security as entertainment, just a theory. So let's look what if security was sold in the same way that we would sell Big Bang Theory. You'd have posters up all over the building, you'd have probably cardboard cutouts of characters in reception that people would take selfies with, anyone under 35 anyway. You'd have merchandise and you'd have bits and pieces. You could buy the box set probably, if those of you who've still got a DVD drive on an old piece of equipment back at home. And you'd have a trailer.
This office has a leak.
Some sensitive information has been sort of given to the wrong hands.
I keep my work phone on a chain. Where is my phone?
Chloe, I can't log in. Have you guys seen a blue USB key?
Look up. Ransomware.
Why didn't any of you report it so I could put a block on it?
How can I lose control of my own laptop?
They've hacked his account. They're reading his emails.
We've got a brilliant bunch of people, and Lionel.
Oh. If they can't bring at least 15 million to the table, then we don't need to have a meeting.
You put everything from your hard drive in a cloud service that hasn't been approved by IT.
Who on earth would actually fall for that?
But just be more careful next time.
I think you're an idiot.
These people have been trained.
You don't know how good their security is.
Oh no!
So that's what that would look like. imagine. And so some of the rules that we're kind of going with here is working out what works with employees and what is safe to communicate with. If you think of virals that go around, obviously some of them possibly not safe for work, but if you're going to put this out as a corporate type of communication, some entertainment-based communication, and even whether it's not, it doesn't have to be as elaborate as this, it could be something as simple as a comic. I think the important thing about things like that, and people do use comics as a device, just make sure it's not too patronizing. Just write it for adults. I think there are certain rules that we sort of have to go by. It helps if the communications are familiar. Like if you told a story about somebody else in an office, that's more relevant than somebody on the moon or a superhero. You have vivid, relatable characters. I don't know any superheroes, but I do know a Lionel. We all know a Lionel. It's the guy in the office that's got, you don't have to be mad to work here, but it helps on his mug. That's how you know it's him. Apologies if anyone has got that mug. Awkward. Looks like you've all got that mug. Right, okay. A popular trope is an idiot hero double act. We have the guy that gets it right and the guy that gets it wrong, because it provides balance. We have a character that employees would look at and go, well, I don't want to be that guy. Yeah? Diversity is important in your communications. If you're going to create characters, obviously you have to be diverse. If you are going to use humor, be clear on the takeaway, because while we're laughing, we might forget the reason why we were watching or reading the poster or whatever it was you might do. But be brave. Don't be frightened of using humor. People are scared of it, but there are ways that you can use humor that are not patronizing and walk that fairly thin line of being relevant and funny and attractive. And I would always say, try to connect the message that you're telling somebody. Let's say it could be something as obscure as document classification. Try to make it have a personal consequence. If you're telling the story about somebody who did something wrong, try not to just worry about the corporate data, which can be a bit of an amorphous, unrelatable concept to some people. If you say, if you do this, this might get back to you in some way, or personally this would affect you, then that's really helpful because people can relate it to their own lives. Another thing that people do is to also widen the scope out of the messages you want to share at work, and you take the message home. So if we treat this as a holistic thing, that our whole lifestyles should be safer and more cognizant of information security threats, that helps also. So something that, you know, maybe you would produce a postcard of just top tips for mums and dads to take home to make certain platforms safer for their kids. My message there would be, as a parent, get involved and pay attention, because so many parents just let their kids sit in their room and surf the net completely unfettered, which is terrifying. Talking about being clear on the takeaway, if you do have comedic characters and things like that, you can use them to provide continuity through your training. So this might be an example of a PowerPoint slide. You've used a character from something else that you've used, so you start to develop a brand within the organization for information security awareness. They see a character, they know it's to do with you. We can create a fan base, believe it or not. I believe that if we can use entertainment effectively, we can create a fan base. Why can't we all be like The Mentalist? Does anyone know that TV series from America that is called The Mentalist? It was this guy that had Sherlock Holmes-type perceptive abilities, and he could look at you and decide what it was you did for a living. He would work out whether you'd eaten that day, and he could work out where you'd been. He noticed details. Noticing details is a really good trait we would like our employees to have. If we see somebody wandering around the building, we want to be able to say, excuse me, that's not right. You should be attended. You should have somebody with you. Can I help you? You know, obviously, being British, we're quite shy about doing that. We don't like to interrupt anybody. It might cause a fuss. Americans really good at it, apparently. Yeah. So they're brave, that's why. We can develop a network of sensors across the organization. I know this is a phrase that's been used before. Treating your employees as sensors, they can ping back little things that they've noticed. This is especially important during a phishing attack or something like that, where they've noticed an email that they weren't expecting, and you've heightened their acuities to be able to spot those sorts of things. They're getting harder and harder to spot, but it is this sort of entertainment-based training can really be good at that sort of thing. So if we get employees to develop interpersonal and observational skills, we want that. like Eddie Murphy in Beverly Hills Cop. He's in a club during the day and he notices a guy at the bar with a long coat on and he's like, why the big coat? It's July. Those are the sorts of connections. If you haven't seen the scene, there's a guy, he's got guns under the coat, which is why he was wearing the big coat. Those sorts of skills are really important. One thing, if you're using video, and a lot of people do this, like the animation I showed earlier, videos are really the wrong medium for delivering a ton of information. If you've got a lot of bullet points and a lot of detail about legislation and about things you should do, video is truly the wrong medium for this. And yet we see time and time again a lot of training that has lots of animations with lots of content. And that is not the way to consume those sorts of that sort of information. It's really good at delivering concepts and context to why the training has to happen in the first place. And if you are going to use entertainment, that doesn't replace the compliance training. That is your back channel. The posters and the awareness are non-compulsory. I can watch it, I don't have to watch it. I can look at it, I don't have to look at it. It's really important that, so that people can make a choice. Okay, so if you have a newsletter, for example, if you are a brilliant humorist and a writer, that's great. Not all of us are, but if you know somebody who is, let's engage them. Go and find out where your local comedy club is and go engage a comedian and say, could you help me with my newsletter? It sounds like a bizarre idea, but this is what I would do. Newsletters are amazing, by the way. They can be absolutely...
You're Rob, right?
Yeah.
Rob, internal communications Rob.
Yeah.
You wrote the quarterly newsletter?
Yeah.
I'm Karen. I just needed to tell you that your recap of the quarterly regional sales meeting was... It changed my life around. I mean, your work with the semicolons was just amazing.
I know, right?
Forgive me for saying this, but you are a genius with your clip art. I mean, the way you coordinate your clip art with your segments, they just correlate so well, and they are just so spot on, and I mean, the last one that you chose was just, I'm sorry, but it really affected me, and I need to hold you.
So yeah, newsletters can be amazing. Let's talk about comedy for a moment. The biggest fear about comedy is, will it travel? We have cultural issues with comedy. If you're careful and you stay away from wordplay as the joke, comedy can travel. If it's character-based, it's great because you can work out hierarchy, you have vivid characters. Character-based comedy definitely works. Ask yourself if your organization has a culture that can support humor. I know it sounds ridiculous, but some businesses just don't. It's not for everybody. But actually, the people that make that sort of decision tend to be a lot older. And if you're getting new, if you're a growing company, you're probably getting a lot of younger employees join the... Oh. All right. Oh, thank you. So, oh, weird. Very weird. It might be. Look how suspicious you lot are. Sorry, that's just a sandwich I left over there earlier. Thank you. The culture is very important, and the older people won't be there forever, and cultures are changing all the time, so we can do that. And how do we measure effectiveness of something like this? Well, with ambient media and things like that, it's very difficult. But I would just look at little things like the number of reportings that usually go up, to be honest, once you mount a campaign of some kind. You think it's getting worse, but it's just the stuff you didn't know about. People have decided to recognize it and report it to you. There's a lot you can do. I'm going to open up now for questions, if that's okay. Anybody got any questions about using entertainment to change employee behavior? Or thinking like a marketer? Or are you going to leave that to the boys and girls coloring in the marketing department? Oh, you, sir.
Yep.
Oh, there you go. Thank you.
Yeah, I actually kind of wanted to ask on the other side. So if you're working in a company that has like lots of people that are interested in marketing and stuff like that.
Yeah.
What would you want to do to make sure that people actually stay on point? So there's lots of people passionately communicating things,
some of which might
actually be useless or not high priority.
Ah, so this is, are they internally communicating, you mean? Yeah, yeah. So there's a lot of traffic in organizations, and I think this is the trouble with information security. It can be perceived as a little bit dull. I know, shocker. But the problem, if you can think of a single issue type of campaign that brings them in line, it will sit above everything else they're doing. You just make it really bold. Use bold images. Memes are a good idea, because actually, it's something that people understand the language of. If you see that picture with the text top and bottom, you immediately know what we're dealing with. And it's ironic, there's layers of communication over that kind of thing. You can own that. I mean, how many other people send out internal memes in your company right now?
Probably hundreds.
Really?
Yes.
You use them as communication within the company already?
Yeah.
That's pretty
more
progressive.
Than paragraphs.
Is it official or is it a back channel? Is it kind of underneath the radar?
Pretty official, yeah.
Oh, wow. Okay. Well, are you an agency by any chance?
No, Google.
Google, right. Okay.
Yeah.
No, I've heard of you. I've definitely heard of you. Yeah. So Google, you would expect to be on the forefront of that kind of thing. You're already doing it. So maybe you could have some fun with the opposite of creativity. Maybe off the top of my head, I would go with a kind of public information film from the 1950s. Do you see what I'm saying? So it's like, gentlemen and ladies, just don't. It's that sort of Chumley Warner sort of delivery. Maybe something that was anti-cool, as it were, would break through the noise. If everything flying around is super bold and super cool, the quietest person in the room is now the one you've noticed. And so my advice to you to be pick something that goes just upstream against all of that. Is that helpful?
Yeah, thanks for that.
All right, thank you. Does anyone else have any questions?
You,
sir. Sorry.
Wait,
oh.
One sec.
Oh, right.
So everyone can hear.
Thank you.
Hi. I'm just wondering regarding everything you've said. It's really actually entertaining. I'm just wondering whether you've launched anything like within any company. What about the results or any change in behavior?
It's a good question. We have launched lots of campaigns in lots of companies over the years, last 3 years actually, where we've been using entertainment. The feedback we've got, interestingly, has been fantastic. It's the first of all, there's two types of feedback. There's quantitative, like how many reportings were there, how many devices got lost or stolen. Interesting point. The first thing that somebody does when they lose their cell phone, unless they've been well trained by you, is they contact the company to get a replacement handset. That's all they care about. Actually, they should be talking about IT wiping it remotely and locking it down. But it's the second call that they often make. But the idea is that you have that quantitative feedback. So we do move the needle on doing that. It's hard to attribute that just to the awareness training, because there's obviously compliance training as well. On the other side, there's qualitative feedback, which is the anecdotal evidence. And what you do see happening a lot is people will contact the IS department and say, thank you, that was hilarious. That was really cool. I love that. Can I show that video at home? Or can I send that meme to my friends outside the company? That kind of thing is great, because you're now having a conversation about security, which you weren't before. Now that, some people say, well, I can't measure that. Well, no, but I think it has value. I think it's really useful to have the conversation going. And it is about starting the right kinds of conversations. Is this a phishing attempt? It looks so real. Ask somebody. Be suspicious. Develop those skills. So I can't give you a definitive answer, but on the whole, what happens that didn't happen before is there's a positive conversation with the IS department, and they have a much cooler image now than they had before, because those are the cool guys that did that awesome poster that made me laugh and snort coffee down my nose. And that's what happens. Does that help a little bit?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else got any questions? Oh, you, sir. Oh, sorry, making
the... so polite.
We're making Britta
well
run around
trained.
Now. She's getting
good.
The exercise
in.
I
need my steps in.
Hiya.
Hi.
Are you familiar with the practice of companies phishing their own employees
yes,
to kind of
yes,
gauge their...
That's, right. That's usually called a campaign of a different kind, yeah.
Yeah, well, what's your reaction to that? Are you kind of in favour of that? Do you feel like it damages engagement?
Well, two things I'll say about that. I know there's lots of companies that do that, and they weave in with the offering some awareness training as well, because usually at the point you've got phished, there's a, da-da, you're pointing to this training. You are broken. We need to fix you now. I feel that, first of all, in the early days of the phishing simulations that went out, people got offended. It was all like a gotcha. Aha, idiot. Duh. People don't want to feel like they were got. So that's changed. People are much more delicate now. I think they've responded to feedback, so that's got better. I wonder, but the great thing you guys will love is that you can track it. You get a number. 22.5% of your workforce opened clicked on the link. And that's interesting. So it shows you where you can point the guns, as it were. I actually, now that it's developed and it's a lot more delicate, I'm more of a fan of phishing simulations than I used to be. I used to worry about making somebody feel stupid. It's a bit like when you get extra charges at the end of your holiday booking, and you think, oh man, you know, just put another 300 quid's worth of charges on. Thank you, Ryanair, or whatever, you know. Because I didn't print out my boarding pass. Oh, yeah. We don't want to feel that way. It's a negative experience. We want to remove that friction and be positive. But I'm in favor generally now. It's evolved.
Okay, thanks very much.
All right, thank you. Yes. Cheers. We've still got about 6 minutes.
In the back.
We'll probably fit another couple of questions in, probably.
Okay, we've been here 5 minutes. Someone interrupted your presentation, brought a package up to the front. What's in the package?
Well, at this point, he's very suspicious. Should it be ticking?
He's being fished.
It's ticking. It's not real. It's not. This doesn't look real. I'm gonna. Unless anyone's got any other questions that are burning, but I'm gonna be around during the break. If you want to talk to me, just come and say hello. I should say that at this point, I'm just gonna break. I'll just end the show. Willy the Wombat, unbeknownst to our friend Mr. Williamson over there. Recently became kind of a global phenomenon. You see, Mr. Wombat, it's that one, and you can get merch. And I ordered this for you. If you could like to accept this as a thank you for giving us your story. This is the... This, there you go, so that's just for you. Thanks for sharing your story, I really appreciate it. Cheers now.